Thank you. I sit in the middle between the lawyer and the technician. So just for a disclaimer, I would be happy to take your questions. I probably have 3 or 4 questions for the two of them. And then probably you drop in. We will not be able to give you a whole GDPR explanation, but it's a start in terms of getting awareness as well. I want to start with you, Bernard. When we had the first discussion, you were totally enthusiastic about this in terms of what will happen to your business if the GDPR happens. What is your biggest fear that will happen in the business and how it will affect your daily life?
Well, from a data perspective, the biggest fears are what actually lawyers will do. At least we will shut down and limit our analytic capabilities when we want to analyze the data.
What do you mean by we want to analyze our data?
For example, within the data science perspective, if you're giving data, I want to create fancy machine learning algorithms, deep learning, AI, the whole stuff you could imagine that you read through if you read through the paper. Of course, this has some legal implications. My fear is that we're not allowed to use or get the maximum out of the data that is currently stored.
Okay. Would you get a problem with that in your company if you can't get out the maximum of the data that you want?
Well, I mean, right at the moment, I'm targeted that legal has blocked me, and in that sense, I of course cannot address the whole bunch of business problems probably that my customers or my company provided me.
Mm-hmm. Sounds sad. Teresa, from a legal point of view,
the bad guys, I know.
Yeah.
Everything.
What is, because this law is about protecting data and protecting privacy, what is it that this law actually wants to achieve? And I think then in the discussion we want to discuss how you can achieve it. But
Maybe the first thing, I'm not sure if everyone is aware of this. The protection at the moment, as the regulation puts it, is only about data of individuals. It's not about company data, it's data of natural persons. Company data will be covered by a different directive on trade secrets.
Can you see a person of the company, a CEO of the company? Do you call that personal or you're...
No, I mean, your data as a person in whatever environment, when you go shopping, when you work, when you interact with your kids, whatever, because the really bad thing about what happened so far is the profiling issue, because this is the glass person where you can see everything anyone does, and that's something which is basically a human right. In earlier days it was about you should not open letters that are not addressed to you. I mean this is a simple thing, but it has developed very fast, and like always the law is lagging behind the technical and scientific possibilities. But the problem is because especially the media and also consultants looking for a lot of money created this fear, which somehow created people being paralyzed. It's just like, oh my god, those fines and we cannot do anything anymore. And it's just blocking everything away, and it's also blocking away the aim of this law, which is to protect people in their privacy. And the trouble is because it has not really been protected, and everything that can be done has been done, and most companies, not only big data companies, most companies have loads of data unorganized or maybe sometimes organized they can use, and to go back and organize them and give them some kind of processing system is extremely expensive and time-consuming, and that's why this is coming from we can't.
But Bernard said we should not talk about making what you said, when you said what we are not covering. So is it really about understanding what data you have, or is it restricting Bernard in his terms of great data analysis?
Maybe something in addition, which is a misunderstanding. I think the real problem that will be coming up is not the fines, but it's the increased rights of every individual to ask, what do you have? I don't want this, please erase it. Do not have automated decisions, whatever. This is uncontrolled. And there are already some NGOs building up, like Max Schrems, None of Your Business organization, and they will take care as of 25th May of those rights, and they can actually, if they start sending in requests to the doctor next door or to your company, it doesn't matter, they can paralyze everything.
Will your company be prepared for that?
And that's
sure.
And that's why what we as lawyers try to do, to give an idea what you need to have to be prepared if such requests are coming
in. What do you need?
And the first thing you absolutely need is someone or a team responsible for those requests. Because the best, the worst case is requests are coming in and they are somehow delegated and going round within the company and no one is really reacting or no one is reacting in a professional way, and then it's getting big. It's usually to be part of the compliance team or legal or HR, somehow a point in the company where most things meet. So there is someone who can get all the information, and this is really serious because this person also has to be disclosed on the website or wherever, so that everyone knows whom to contact.
Excuse me, before you said, when you were referring to the rights of the individual that is given by this GDPR, that this area is uncontrolled. Do you mean that authorities will not prosecute companies who do not respond in due time to requests of consumers?
If the company does not respond and you have to respond fast, mm-hmm. there are some, it says just immediately.
I think right? 4 weeks.
When the request is coming in, you have to say, okay, we got it and we will take care of it and then we'll answer. And if there is no adequate answer of the company, then they will go to the data protection authority. Mm-hmm. And then the fine or other measures starts. Uncontrolled, I did not mean it's uncontrolled regarding the company, it's uncontrolled regarding the requests, because everyone can.
Okay.
That's the point, and that's the real risk everyone can, and as we all know regarding other topics, people who are not so content with their life or whatever, they want to go against the big ones, things like that, they can really be a great nuisance. Mm-hmm. And the thing you need to have is something just to present and say, we will take care of it in a very professional way.
But
yep.
Can I just one follow-up question? How do you judge the severity, how the data protection agency is going to treat this? I mean, is it like car has been stolen, or is it more like somebody stole a chewing gum?
They hired lots of staff, mm-hmm. but I think for some months they will be completely overwhelmed and they mm-hmm. will not know how to react, and we will not, I expect, no fines until the end of the year, mm-hmm. because it will take time, because as we all know, until now it was a bit of a dead law, not really lived, and they will have to take over and get used to it and also diversify between real requests and just crazy requests or requests that actually aim to gain money.
But they are legally obliged to follow a complaint.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. So it will be a lot of.
And if you cannot, as a company, if you cannot give some answer, you are on the road to some kind of measure. Mm-hmm. That's the point.
I have two questions. The first is, how much of this is a pushback when it comes to Google and Facebook, and American companies and Europeans basically having more control over these multi-billion-dollar companies? So it's a political I'm wondering how much of this is being driven by money from the US taking over. And my second question is, I don't think you understand that I'm Canadian, I'm from Toronto. That I, you know, I had a conversation with somebody yesterday saying, asking me, Danilo, what do you think about continuing business in Europe? Because our American friends apparently don't want to do business with Europeans because of May 25th.
Yeah, well, I mean, I cannot really answer this. It has been quite a success that this regulation has even been born, considering how Europe works or doesn't work at all. And it has always been somehow a fight between the European Union and the US, because there's a completely different approach, and the impact on economic relations between the US and Europe, well, data protection is definitely not the only issue. And
well, when Angela Merkel can be followed by the CIA and the NSA and finds out, whoops, that she's being followed, I find it very difficult that your GDPR, whatever you want to call it, is going to be able to protect anybody. I mean, anybody.
Yeah, but you know, the point is, before this came into force, or will be coming into force, we didn't even have the instruments. Now we have the instrument. If they will be applied and how they will be applied, we will see. As we know, money rules the world, and data are the new currency, and so on and so forth. But if you don't even have the law, it's hopeless.
Yeah. And so, I mean, there is this discussion has been there. Do you want to say that? But this discussion, we had this discussion in three other meetups as well, and it's always the same question. Is it an economic advantage or non-advantage, how you deal with data?
I don't like it if somebody opens up my mail.
Yeah.
Because I don't know who opened my mail. You had East Berlin people listening to their neighbors and writing very long notes in terms of where they went and who they saw. All of this espionage and basically following your neighbors has been part of the culture of Europe and many other places around the world. So I'm all for protecting my rights and my privacy. I'm 100% behind that. I believe that. I'm not against what you're doing. My whole point is, what's driving this? And if it's being driven because, you know, the Germans are basically afraid of Google and Facebook, I think they have good reason to be. I think they do. But I think they should come out and say, you know, you guys are making billions of dollars in money and it's not our data, but you're using our data because we're on your platform and it's free.
I think it's a mix of it.
I don't think that anonymized data are completely worthless. It's like all over the world that if you anonymize, you cannot use it for economic reasons, for marketing, for health statistics, whatever. You can, you are just not used to do it because it was no issue to anonymize them or to encrypt them or whatever. And I think there needs to be some change in the perception of this. It will take some time, but at the moment, everyone who asks, it doesn't make sense if you cannot identify the people behind the data. But I think if you are creative in big data work, you can make something out of it, even if it's anonymized. And at the moment it's anonymized, it's no problem.
Yeah.
Well, also,
take the question.
Okay. Currently in the academia, for example, they propose several algorithms that you can work on this anonymized data. But as you say, people are currently not addicted to that in that sense. I think after the 25th, well, they have to deal with the anonymized data, otherwise it will break GDPR.
Yeah, but let's be realistic, a lot of companies just don't want to anonymize it because they want to know for this specific person how it works. I have another question. The man in the blue shirt first, and then the man in the dark blue shirt. I see blue is the color of the day. Oh no, gray, sorry.
I think you have to state the law seriously. It's beginning, it's to be effective on 25th of May. There are a lot of paragraphs there. I think there are big five, if I remember correctly. Each company, about 250 employees, have to implement so-called DPO, data processing officer, and so on. There is a record of processing activity, and so on. You have to organize your data, and there are, in German, so-called Erwägungsgründe, reasoning, and I am reading it in this way. We are increasing the competition. There are a lot of paragraphs, as I mentioned. One of them is data portability. And with this law, European Union, as I am reading it, want to increase the competition, want to improve, optimize the market, to give more power, more liquidity, more optimization to the market.
Yes, the right to data portability is one of the principles, meaning as many consumers so far did not really change the providers of whatever because they denied the full package of data to be used by the competitor. That's one of the good things, I would say. But sure, I mean, you know, the system worked without protection quite nicely. And the change is always very difficult, and that's why everyone says, no, we don't want this, but I think it's a good thing. And if you are prepared, and if you have documentation on what you do and how you encrypt, it is an effort, but it will pay.
So what do you do with your big companies that you deal with on a daily basis? What do they ask you to do, basically?
Well, actually, what I ask them to do is to have really proper records of processing. That's the second thing. The first thing I said was the responsible person or responsible team, and the next one is records of processing. And even if you do not even have 250 employees, it really, because that is mandatory, but it also makes sense if you only have, I don't know, 50 employees, because you need to know what happens with data within your company and with your contract partners, because they go in and out and wherever, and you don't know. So,
to pick up this point, for example, GDPR drives almost your data, metadata, or data governance, because there you usually should store when, where, what data mm-hmm. is processed in which manner. Otherwise, you will get a tremendous problem tracking back which algorithm has used or compiled which data in which sense.
Who is doing this at the moment in his office? This data? Okay. Like in terms of really knowing, tracking, analyzing things. So will it be a big change for you in your daily business?
Yes, of course. From optimization point of view, this is opening a lot of possibilities. Not only data governance, but you can optimize your own processes. Mm-hmm. You can go into deep with another industry and so on. We can go to the connection to the blockchain and this kind of new technical development. This is opening up tremendous possibilities.
Mm-hmm. The gentleman with the
duck. But I have two very quick comments and then a question. I would agree with the gentleman in the light blue shirt and basically say it doesn't matter where it came from. This thing is real. It goes back quite a few years, actually, the plan for this. And it's going to have an effect on day one. I feel as a developer, there's a new nonprofit that got formed by Max Schrems. He's promising to sue on day one for companies that are not in compliance. It's already had an effect with Facebook. They've already moved their worldwide headquarters out of Ireland so that US citizens will not be protected in the same way that European citizens would have, or are, because if they had stayed in Ireland, everybody would have had to be protected. But my question really is, it's not, for me as a developer, keeping user data anonymous that most concerns me. What concerns me is the automatic processing provisions. If I'm developing a bot that is supposed to take a user's preferences into account so that I can provide a personalized experience, it becomes incredibly awkward and painful as a user experience if I have to opt in for, ask them to opt in for every piece of information they provide. And it's not clear from the GDPR what's tied to a session, what's tied to a cross-session. This whole automatic processing bit, even if the data is kept not passed on, is still what's really not clear to me as I'm developing software that's supposed to be user-friendly.
So your question is?
My question is really for, we're not supposed to talk about security,
but
I'd really like to hear some details as to how GDPR should be interpreted in terms of developing a user profile for user-friendliness, for instance, in an automatic bot. And I don't know whether the legal community's got any information or anybody else has got any information.
I think this is quite specific to you.
Well, yeah, that's a good point in that sense. Automatically, well, since you have to address somehow this automatically developing, I mean, if you think about, for example, science part, I mean, machine learning, for example, is fully automatized. So once you have, you collect the data, what I would do is raise an record in this metadata and say, okay, this specific property comes because you have opt-in, for example, that in this Euler, for example. If you do not track that one, and for example, the user is say, yeah, please do not do that after this particular time point, then of course you have to stop to process it. So, if you want to do automatically profiling user profiles, I think you have to be very concrete in that sense. It's not enough to say, okay, here's the full list, you are accepting that one. I think that's not in that sense a feasible or valid solution anymore.
It happens even for any recommendation engine, whether on Amazon I don't know, an app that's recommending whether there are Chinese restaurants in the neighborhood. If I don't positively respond to Chinese restaurants and I only respond to pizza recommendations, then that user now is associated with somebody who is interested in Italian food. Is that okay to store? Or is that not okay to store? Even if I never sell it, even if I never use it in some third-party marketing.
But I think...
Yep.
Ladies first.
Sorry. Why would you want to store it if you do not intend to use it?
No, I do intend to use it as a way to provide...
In what way?
Personal recommendations. In the same way that Netflix recommends movies.
But one of the big principles of the regulation is the purpose. Everything is orientated on what the purpose is. And there also comes in how it is proportionate, the means and the purpose. So you need to have some explanation in your records why you need to store these data not anonymized for what purpose exactly.
And is there which purpose is allowed? So if you want to make money, I know you say user experience, but why do you want to improve user experience? Your colleague.
That could be the whole purpose of the app.
Yeah, exactly. So it's about an app that wants to earn money in the end, is it? It's a business purpose, usually. No?
Yes.
Total? Yeah, but it has to be equilibrium between the business purpose and the privacy rights.
But who gives me the answer where the equilibrium is?
There is no answer yet.
But that's the whole point.
Yeah,
that's
but for that we will need to have decisions of the authorities and of the courts because it's not in the text.
Yeah,
it's just quite stretchable definition.
Yeah, but this is very good because I want to follow up what the gentleman said because there is a company doesn't collect data to, let's say, do bad things. It collects data about the customer to improve either the customer experience or to give personalized recommendations.
To say more.
Yes, and it doesn't have to be so.
Sorry,
no,
but,
no, no, no.
But from my experience, many companies collect data not in an extremely organized way. The purpose is for sure to use them for whatever improvement, but they somehow collected them in the tons and stored them however, wherever, whatever, and took out something they thought they needed at the moment.
So
and that's the
but
first
often you,
thing.
You
it
do
has
not
to be
know how to you how you can use the data. You do not know in advance of.
Yeah, so you just store them forever until you can use it, in, and that will not be possible anymore.
Can I ask a simplified version of what I asked? Not selling the data.
Yeah.
I'm a brand new company. I don't have data.
Yeah.
Now, let's say I'm a brand new company and I want to start a subscription service. Right? I'm making this up now, but
mm-hmm.
I want to start
a
restaurant recommendation service
mm-hmm.
based on where you're walking.
Mm-hmm.
And I charge you a euro a month for that, okay?
Yep.
And I develop a profile of you, and that makes it worthwhile for you to use my service.
Mm-hmm.
And I promise never to sell the data to the town
mm-hmm.
restaurants, but how do I build that application in a way that allows me to build up a profile to make it useful with all the guardrails that the data isn't being sold and it's still your data? How do I do that?
We will not to answer that whole question. I mean, the first step is to really think about what you really want to do and put it into a form. Yeah.
But if his customers give consent while using the service and paying 1 euro a month, then what? But consenting to what?
One of the big purposes is that you need the data to fulfill a contract.
Mm-hmm.
And in this way, you get an informed consent where the customer or anyone says, okay, I want to have a contract with you and you need those data, and until I do not want it anymore, you can use it.
So if
and you need to store those consent declarations, and also if they are withdrawn.
Mm-hmm.
And it's possible to have a rather easy system for this, and then nothing can happen.
But this will also,
I think it
will also better educate consumers, because you will really see what the effect is.
Yeah.
Because nowadays, most people, not in this room obviously, but most people, they don't realize what all these profiles and analytics is doing for them. They're just using these apps that they're used to use them, and okay, it just falls out of the sky for them, all these things that this app do for them.
Maybe
and now they will see, okay, if I give consent, I get the service. If I don't, suddenly the service, the benefit is gone. I have to give service away. Or I don't want this company to process my data, so I am withdrawing the consent forever. Okay,
and I think this will bring in some discipline.
Mm-hmm.
Automatically.
But my read of the GDPR is that it's not sufficient to ask for consent once. It's not sufficient for me to say, I'm going to store your restaurant preference data. And then if I then decide that I'm going to store park data, I have to ask for that. I mean, every piece of data that helps me build up a profile.
For each and every purpose, you need consent.
So there is no checkbox at the beginning.
No.
So if
but
a company has a new idea to, let's say, a new business idea, so you always have to get the consent of the
but
company.
If I go to Bila,
so this differs
I
completely innovation.
Milk and yogurt today.
It is.
That differs completely innovation.
No, it doesn't.
No, but the consumer has more choice to decide, I want this new service or I don't want it. That is basically the purpose. Sorry, I have a few more questions that you want next one.
Just a short question. What does anonymized mean? If I cannot track the personal information like the name or the address in my database, if there's just a made-up username, for example, is this an anonymized data set?
No.
If you cannot track back to the individual, it's anonymized.
If the username is 123 for example, is this is anonymized?
I can give you an example, for example, regarding medical data. If you only have age, sex, I don't know, race is already difficult, but if you don't have it in a way that you can, if you combine it, say, okay, that's me, then it's okay. And it's the same thing with all those applications. If you cannot track back to the natural person.
I understand this, but is the link to the natural person, is it sufficient to have a number or any username? Or is it required that the database has the real name and the real address for making this anonymized?
Okay.
Well, the answer is, the point here is an anonymous data set is not able to identify one individual. An individual could be either a network person or an individual. And the critical path here is more or less you have quasi-identifiers that are attributes that are not a key or something like that. They can be grouped together and identify you as an individual back again.
Okay.
For example, what could be this, if you have a look in the academia, they have plenty of papers based on that. So normally, as I think a sex, date of birth, and I think postleitzahl, so a zip code is enough that you will be identified again.
Okay.
And from a technical perspective here, the hard point is that the quasi-identifiers could not be processed in an efficient manner. So it takes you at least very, very long until more or less your data set is probably outdated to enumerate all possibilities of that, because one combination eliminates all the anonymization approach.
Almost.
Almost.
So, the example you mentioned, is this anonymized data or not?
It's not.
Okay, that's thanks.
So, my questions are twofold. I have one legal one and one technical one. The legal one is, I think, from what I read into the GDPR, how it's dealt with that, for example, if I have my information with Google, could you elaborate a bit on this, how this is dealt with if my data is stored in another outside of Europe?
Actually, I wouldn't, because this is extremely difficult in some countries. I could talk about this like 2 hours, and it's really too difficult.
Okay,
because the regulation is really all about Europe, and the moment data leave Europe, it's a special system of... Yeah.
Okay. Then just a technical question, at the beginning we had in your slides actually the right to explanation for automated processing. How far does this, maybe it's a question of the courts then later, how far does it go really? Yes. But do you think, as a data scientist, do you think there is also a technical limit in how far we understand how algorithms work? Because of course if I ask you, okay, how do you process my data, you can give me some numbers that appear in the deep learning.
This is exactly the purpose.
But is this an explanation if I have no idea what these numbers mean?
Well, saying I have no idea is always quite a bad explanation. The point here is that you already provide more or less the answer. I mean, no one knows exactly what happens in a deep learning network.
Yeah.
So basically what you could do is saying this is the input data, this is more or less my black box, I don't know how this internally happened. And this is my output, and try to infer from the output to the input. That is definitely feasible. And for example, if you have a look at, for example, Lime, that basically tries to do that.
Lime
is a R package for more or less trying to explain the input, or at least the reason why this happened in deep learning.
I think the first case that's brought that says, and where somebody responds, I have a deep learning package and here was the input and here was the output, and that's the explanation, I think the company will be liable immediately.
Hopeful.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Do you want to say?
No.
Yes. Next question. Unicorn.
Yeah, I have a question actually about what is considered profiling. So, at what level of detail of learning from the data set do you decide what this was profiling? Because some of these things, you know, we've been doing this with statistics for centuries, not just for 10 years. So, for example, insurance companies decide how much to charge you based on your sex and your age. Under GDPR, is that considered profiling?
But from a technical perspective, profiling is quite clear that once you have a profile that is related to someone, that is called technically profiling. From a legal perspective.
Well, I, from a very simple point of view, profiling is not only to know who someone is, but what someone does 24/7. And you can deduct from this a lot of information you can sell.
So if I have a data set and I figure out that, you know, I can sell particular products to people between the ages of 20 and 30, am I allowed to use this without having received prior consent?
You cannot use it.
Okay, so it is a kind of profile.
For example, this special device that has to be in the cars since, I think, April, there are two different versions. The one is that is legally required, which does not give more, it's just used in case of an accident. But the ones the producers provide, and they are obliged to inform you that this is in your car, most people do not ask, it gives every information where you have been, how often you brake, how often you accelerate, how many kilometers you drive a day, where you drive to, how long you stay there, and this is definitely not allowed without an express consent.
I wasn't asking about, I mean, it's clear when you collect
it was
that
supposed
much
to be
data
an example.
Do you mean from a statistic point of view? So you have a range.
What level does it become profiling? I mean, how much data do I need to have on a person and process on that person so that it then will fall under the law? If all I know about the user is their gender, okay, and I don't have any other data on this person, but I am able to make some predictions simply based on their gender. Am I profiled?
Then you cannot connect it to an individual if you only know about gender.
Right,
profiling is the connection to an individual.
Are you inferring from cohorts? Like you have 3,000 men and 1,000 women, and you just know those two metrics?
This is what profiling does, no? I mean, it picks out certain characteristics of the user.
I think the explanation here was if you say you have 3,000 men, namely 1, 2, 3, 4,
right,
and 1,000 women, 1, 2, 3, 4,
yeah,
then I understand those profiling. Whereas if you basically just look at the entirety of those people,
mm-hmm,
then it's not profiling by definition because it doesn't concern an individual.
Yeah, it actually says to evaluate certain personal aspects relating to a natural person. And just male or female, it's not a natural person.
But it's an aspect.
But is the velocity...
Yeah, it's connected to a person.
I mean, we need to have the link
concepts. Because profiling, from a statistical point of view, is more, okay, I have certain metadata or certain characteristics, but it's not connected with an individual person. And with that, I could still do something that I understand. It's not going to be under GDPR because I'm not connecting this data with a personal individual.
Yes. Profiling
from
of,
the point
yeah.
of view of GDPR, which
yeah.
is a different, same word but different concept, is more that you have so much data that you could, with
the
all of this,
point.
You could exactly pinpoint is this person.
I don't think that's right. I think the GDPR includes both types. Identifying
okay.
the individual and automatic processing based on a group profile. And I think that if you do automatic process, you're an insurance company
yeah.
and you decide that you want to offer an insurance product. And if you want to offer a different rate because they're male versus female,
mm-hmm.
I think you have to first ask, is it okay that I'm going to ask your gender to offer you an insurance product? And if they say no, then you can't do it. If they say yes, and then you can explain the reason your rates are higher is men die of heart attacks more often, then I think you're okay, because you have an explanation as to why the processing is different. That's at least the way I read it.
It's a different profiling according to the regulation and the automated processing are two different concepts.
Okay.
You need consent for both of them, but it's, we have to stick to the wording for the moment of the regulation, and it's differentiated. I don't know how it will be connected when it's starting, but it's a different concept. It's both high risk work.
I have a question.
Sorry, I know when we had like.
Well, just her use case is actually perfect. Because I know the insurance company, and actuarial science actually very specifically identifies you and prices you accordingly. So when I first got my driver's license and I needed to get insurance by law, I was extremely high risk, and they priced me according to the likelihood of me being young and crazy and maybe drinking alcohol and driving and drinking. But I actually, the question, I have a much better question for you. Do you have any insurance companies that are your clients?
I'm asking that because
if you do, then from this perspective, you would understand exactly this question, which is...
No, it's not about understanding or not understanding. But the question is, you were probably not a stupid boy at 18, and if they would have said, you are a stupid boy at 18 because you have done this and this and this and this, and in your school you misbehaved, then it's profiling. But they do a cohort and say, they do it at the moment as well. Yeah, and there's data protection.
But sometimes no data is high risk. And
yeah, but they know
too.
That the guys, when they're 18, they're all
skilled
every time. There is just normal in insurance. It doesn't tell you that you're not allowed to pricing decisions or anything like this, but people need to be aware of that. And if you profile it, then it means, Bernard, you are a very good guy. You have never done anything wrong in your school. You don't fall under the same protection like you, because they connect the data between the profiles.
I mean, you just have to turn it around. If you look at male persons, 18-year-old, with a fresh driving license, from this information, are you able to pinpoint this gentleman?
That's right.
No, you're not.
And therefore,
exactly.
The GDPR does not apply.
Yeah.
We are not able to pinpoint exactly you.
You fall into this category.
They know what postal code I live in.
That's exactly the problem. This is exactly what you're trying to build back into the right balance here. As opposed to the US, where basically it is this last person you have mentioned. Sorry, I have to now to make this remark. Because the point, as I see it, is to use this analogy, this slightly off analogy of this mail that someone else opens for you. Now we're at the stage where basically you don't even receive your own mail.
That's right.
And other people do it. So the way I understand this, in an ideal world where everyone is also a natural person and only a data scientist, everyone would like to have kind of his hands and control of this data. And of course, we are not there. We are exactly on the opposite side of the scale. So we have to put it from here to here. And this process is rather messy. So what I was wondering right now for the last 20 minutes is how much time we spent on talking about whatever, clients, insurances, and all that. Because the point is actually that this legislature is going to
enforce.
Thank you very much. And that is, I believe, the right thing to do. And now we have to really
figure out. I'm in complete agreement with you. Are you kidding? I am not. I am with the lawyer. I'm just trying to figure out like what you're saying. I got to design an algorithm. Tell me if I can use your address. Tell me if I can use your sex. Tell me if you can use your age. If you tell me no, I'm good. I'll figure out a different way. But we already know from MIT that I can use metadata to actually find out that you are 18 and you're a male.
But the 90%, but then getting it 90% right is better than having it 0% right.
Yeah.
And of course, you will always find some loopholes, and you will always find, even from the stupid Netflix movie data set, people are able to infer connecting it to the IMDb individual person. So, I mean, if you can do it with this stupid data set.
Yeah.
mean, no one can actually bring it up to court and say, well, they have to, whatever, erase it from the internet now because I don't want my data out there. The problems are also, I believe, very unique in nature. This is something which you mentioned, the legislature is kind of lagging. So,
how do you handle blockchain?
But can I just go, because we have three more questions
exactly.
for that.
Exactly.
Yeah,
oh
so
God.
The gentleman with the white shirt, and then the lady,
thank
and then
you.
The man.
Sorry.
No, you're absolutely right. I just want to bring you
the. It would be kind of helpful for the discussion if we tone it down a bit. This feels a bit hostile here, and people interrupting others and then shouting.
I can leave
actually, I didn't have a question, but I tried to answer the question of this gentleman who left, so I'm
oh,
maybe
anonymous data thing. Oh, sorry.
Already gone, but it's this notion about the pseudonymization versus anonymization. It's part of the GDPR. It's very important to understand, and it's also very important for the legal side to get a good grip on that, because they're the ones that are currently making the calls when they're advising the company.
Mm-hmm.
So we are actually developing our startup and an anonymization solution on big data, and we approach the companies and they tell us, well, we've got all this data stored. We hash the username, the full name, and the address, and so forth. But the other information that's anonymous. And then we kind of need to bring up the Netflix case and tell, okay, no, simply based on your movie watching history and the ratings, you can re-identify. And as long as that there is a possibility to re-identify, it's not anonymized, but it's pseudonymized. If it's anonymized, it's exempt from the GDPR. So there's a huge opportunity to work on information retaining anonymization techniques, and that's a field that will be progressing and flourishing thanks to the GDPR. But the struggle is here, who makes the call on whether something is now pseudonymized versus anonymized. The de-anonymization attacks are only getting easier and easier because there's more data available that you can use to cross-reference,
mm-hmm.
and you also have smarter machines. So if you take a picture of a person, and you look at it, and well, you have never seen that person. Can you re-identify that? Well, the machine has no issue in scoring that and re-identifying that in 20 milliseconds.
Mm-hmm.
And similarly, with all your digital trails that we're collecting, your cell tower information, your bank transactions, your movie ratings, everything, as long as you have this one-to-one relationship to the individuals, is quite likely to be re-identified. And that's a bit like I'm kind of like it will be interesting to see how it plays out and who makes the call, which judges and which lawyers will actually make this call. But the problem is once you pull it out your data and you think it's anonymized, but it's pseudonymized like Netflix did, there's no way to call it back. You cannot remove it back. Facebook cannot undelete the data that it has shared for academic purposes. And kind of rewrite history. So it's particularly for the ELGAD data, and maybe that's also something that we want to discuss here, is that our personal health records are now allowed to be pseudonymized, handed over for academia. And everyone, I think, agrees that it's in the benefit for the whole society that more and more people work on healthcare data and see and kind of derive now what is the right medication. And still there's the that's one of the most sensitive data that we have out there, aside of financial transaction data. So I think maybe just the pseudonymization versus anonymization, that's very important to get right. And it's there are plenty of studies out there who show the risks of not proper anonymization.
I think there's nothing to add, sir.
No, it's perfect.
One final question.
So my question is regarding third-party responsibility for the data protection, because there are a lot of companies who sell the personal data on their users, and if I am the company who buys the data to do some kind of processing on it, or if I'm a company that does projects for other companies that work with their generated data, like how do I have, or what kind of responsibilities do I have as kind of output people, like as a person as a company that does the project for the other company, or that works for the data generated or collected by another company?
Yeah, it's another issue regarding, you have to look at the contracts you already have and the contracts you conclude. Why you need to find the liability issue in the right way. When you are buying data, you need a guarantee from your data provider that he is in compliance with the regulation. Otherwise, it will be your problem, and the other way around. And I can tell you, most of the contracts I've seen in the last year do not have any specific regulations on that.
So what big companies do at the moment, that's paragraph 28, they just write to all their suppliers and say, please sign this that you're compliant, because the bug stops always with the one who issues the contract.
I have a follow-up question. For example, in the same case, if I've got, for example, data of 100,000 users, do I also have to contact these people and tell, you know what, I have this purpose to use your data, you know, based on, I don't know, some kind of business purpose? Do I also have to notify these users? Or do I just have to make sure that the company that I bought the data from has gotten
this? If you do not have any direct contact, whatever, with the users or the people whose data you're using, your partner is the one providing those data, and you cannot contact them directly. If there is a notification obligation, if your data provider had some violations of the regulation and there was a leak of the data, then you have to inform the users you have direct contact with. But in gaining the data, it's a chain of contracts. But if you have some suspicions that the company you are buying the data from is not in compliance, you are liable also for yourself. For example, if there is information in the media or wherever that there have been some leaks or so, then you have to come back to them and discuss it and get some new liability clauses. You cannot just close your eyes and say, hey, it's my contract partner, I have this warranty, I don't care.
The final question.
Yeah. When is data actually considered to be deleted? So deletion is like good enough? Or yeah.
From a technical perspective, probably not. You just read the data and say it's deleted. Of course, you can say, don't care about the deletion flag. I can probably select it. Or reselected with some at least minor or major efforts.
But assuming that regular people or employees cannot do this, but only a single person, it's called the administrator, will have the access to do so.
Mm-hmm.
From a GDPR point of view, there is this Verhältnismäßigkeit. If this effort is in that sense verhältnismäßig hoch, then it will be probably fine. But depends on what verhältnismäßig is, since I'm not the new person.
We don't know yet. I mean, maybe the one side would be the company going bankrupt because of complying with the regulation. And the other side is the privacy rights. But it really needs case law, because it's not defined in that way in the regulation. It's an indefinite definition. It's always between purpose and means.
Is there any difference between different data? One I need for bookkeeping, other one I need for tracking people's...
Yeah, the purpose has to be seen in relation to the category of... data, category of person, category of recipient, whatever. It's very specific.
So to the case of deletion, sorry?
Yeah.
Okay. To the case of deletion, because it was, I don't know, it was mentioned before, but I was not, so if it's already answered, sorry. So there is a new technology called distributed ledger at the moment, some call it blockchain. You can't delete anything there. It's just impossible. So I asked now a very specific question. Will the blockchain be forbidden after 25th May of 2018?
We don't know.
I don't know either, but
yeah.
But my I have a second follow-up question here. This is based on public-private key. So it's like if I throw away the private key to a part of this blockchain, it's not deleted, but I can never access it anymore. So is that then deletion?
It's not deletion, but it's anonymous probably.
Why anonymized? It's just garbage. It's not something at least usable anymore.
But how can you guys be the sole owner of a private key, but there's not a copy or a backup of the private key?
Yeah, but then it's about the deletion of the private key and not about the data.
You want to?
Yeah. Also, that's who knows if the encryption will hold the next 20 years. Maybe it's good for now, but in 20 years you can break the encryption.
And maybe the Verhältnis music has come. Yeah, can also tell you maybe 50 years I'm dead. So no, yes. I think you have to work with me.
I don't have any time for questions anymore because I have another speaker. This was already official.
The last one.
No, he has a simple one as well.
Me too.
No, may I propose? Probably, do you want to keep the question? We do the next part first, and then we have questions again. I don't know how you in terms of time. Is it for you fun?
Does it expire? So if the data is very old, like 20 years old, can I use it? Or is there anything or not?
If it's very old, it's even more sensitive because you shouldn't have it anymore.
Theoretical question.
It's just in theory.
Asking for a friend.
Just basic thing, does the GDPR and consent requirement change something in I need to do service fulfillment, like sending an invoice, and you give me your name and your address. Obviously, I need it for that, and it has been collected for hundreds of years like this. Do I need consent for that?
I mean, this is a fulfillment of a contract.
Right.
Yes.
So.
And it's implicit.
Yeah.
Because
okay.
It would be strange.
Of course. Of course. Yeah.
For an additional.
So these things don't change.
The
customer gives me name and address so that I can service.
It would be like
yeah.
When a client mandates me and I ask him, do you really want to give me your name so that I can work for you?
Yeah.
That's a bit too much, would be too much.
Okay.
So that doesn't change.
No.
Great.
Good. I know we could go on for ages.